Good evening, everyone. It's lovely to see you all this evening. Thank you for coming. And we're moving towards the end of this series, but this may well be something of a climax. We never know. It's lovely to welcome Bishop Stephen, who is no longer the new Bishop of Oxford, he's well established, and is now expected to know everything about what goes on in the diocese, which is probably more of a burden than a privilege. But thank you very much for coming this evening. We appreciate that. We appreciate especially the last bit of your journey up Whitehorse Lane, which I think is a bit of a shock if you're not expecting it. But it's better now than it was two nights ago. So I don't think there's much more for me to say. There will be a chance for questions at the end, and I'll have a couple of notices at the end as well. But you can see that today's subject is eating and drinking. And before last week's, I said, and Bishop Allen then corrected me when he started showing his pictures, that we were moving from very public kind of ministry of Jesus's into a rather more intimate and private one. Well, certainly today it's Jesus among friends, and so we're going to be really interested in what you've got to say and what you're going to do, I think. But let's start with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we are reminded every week how wonderful it is that we are free to join together to hear your word explained and developed by such distinguished speakers. We give you thanks for the lectures so far and in advance for this evening's talk. We're grateful for all the things that have been expounded to us in the course of this series. And so we pray for Bishop Stephen as he comes to speak to us this evening, and for one another, for those who would like to have been here but who weren't able to come. We pray that you'll be with us through the Holy Spirit throughout this evening's session. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to read the Bible passage. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, Jesus' disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and to say to him, one after another, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread. And after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
Thank you very much indeed. Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you? Good. I hope you are at the end of the evening. And congratulations on your series. I was able to catch up with the flavour of your lectures Very. I didn't watch all of them, Julie, but I did watch. I did watch snippets, and it's a really interesting series. And I don't know whether I was given the topic eating and drinking because this was the date I could come, or because I'm known to enjoy eating and drinking. But in either way, it's really good to be here. And let me give you a flavour of my life and my week. I'm not preparing anything, I hope, too heavy for you this evening. I hope that's all right. But it seemed a lovely opportunity to talk about some of the richness of life this evening and about the Bible passage. I started the week on Saturday with our Diocesan Synod. I was exploring tending and care for creation in the address I gave there. I had a snow day on Sunday because I was due to go to Newbury, and that was the epicentre of the snow, and so couldn't. They rang up and said, "Don't come." So I had a quiet time at home, which was lovely. Last night I was entertaining, and I were entertaining about 30 odd faith leaders from across the city of Oxford. And today we've had our seventh group of people come to talk about renewing how we prepare people for baptism and confirmation across the city. We have 120 people have been to talk about that in our home through Lent. That's been my Lent project. Tomorrow I'm preaching in the city to commemorate the martyrdom of Thomas Cranmer. It's the anniversary of his death. Tomorrow morning, Thursday, I'm chairing a whole day's conversation in London between scientists and theologians on the ethics of artificial intelligence. I sit at my House of Lords Committee on AI. We're about to report, and of course it's top of the news this week, is the ethics of AI. And Friday's my day off, and on Saturday I will be in Buckinghamshire leading a day for the Bucks area on our Diocesan Vision process. And shaping, and then, snow permitting, I will be in Milton Keynes in Christ the Cornerstone on Sunday. So that's my week. I don't know how you would tell your story in terms of food. Your food autobiography. Mine would start with Yorkshire pudding. I'm a Yorkshireman, and both my mum and my dad's mum were great cooks. My mum doesn't cook anymore, she's very frail. They were, in their time, great cooks. And the thing is, are there any Yorkshire people here? Mm-hmm. Oh, there are, excellent, very good. In my youth, in Yorkshire, my grandma was of the generation, and people not from Yorkshire sometimes don't understand this, but it really did happen, where Yorkshire pudding formed the starter. It's what you had before your main course to fill you up. You then often had Yorkshire pudding with your main course, with your meat and two veg. And then my grandma served Yorkshire pudding for dessert. With sugar on. So you might think she was rather a large lady having to say that, but she was quite a slight person. So Yorkshire pudding, I think, will be the first chapter of my food autobiography. And roast dinner would probably be the second chapter of my food autobiography. Anne and I have four children, now adult, and three little grandchildren. I have always been, since our children were little, the normal family cook. I've done the cooking. And found by a process of experiment that it was the only domestic chore I would reliably do when entrusted with. So how it evolved. So cooking roast dinner for our family, and having and discovering really that actually in raising a family, the most important piece of furniture you have is a table and chairs. Often forgotten in homes today, but actually gathering around a table to eat is a critical part of the forming and building of community. And the church gathers around a table to eat. For us, the typical meal, usually on a Sunday, was Sunday lunch and cooking that, and actually yorkshire pudding often featured in that. And the third part of my food autobiography, which is really something that I've come to quite recently. They gave me this on the day my appointment was announced. quite appropriately, I think, really. But it's the making of bread. Does anybody make their own bread?
With a bread maker.
With a bread maker?
Yes.
Without a bread maker? Yeah. I don't use a bread maker. I've never allowed myself to buy a bread maker. Because I know that if I make too much bread, I eat too much bread. As I talk to you this evening, I'm going to experiment by kneading some dough. Your oven doesn't work. But actually, what I'll need, could you be my assistant? Yeah. I need about 6 fluid ounces of warm water. I bet that's the first time he's had to do that. One of the analogies I've used this year as we are exploring as a diocese what it means to be a more Christ-like church is I've tried to use the analogy of working with the two texts we're working with, the Beatitudes and the story of the raising of Lazarus, as being rather like kneading yeast through flour to make dough. So that as we engage with the text of Scripture, we are transformed and changed more into the likeness of Christ.
I use that flour.
Is it good? Yes, I use it too. I've only done this a few times in public. And the second time I did it, it didn't work at all. I weighed out the flour before I went and took exactly the right quantity and then put too much water in the mix. And all I ended up with was a claggy mess. It was good. Putting yeast in here is rather unfortunate for today's reading, which begins on the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So you'll have to forgive that. But as you know, bread is made from the most simple ingredients. Of flour and salt and yeast and water and a bit of oil. No, this is olive oil, it's not lemon juice. Oh, you put lemon juice in this? And I'm going to try hard not to spill anything on the church laptop. Can you have a think, just relaxing. How important meals are in the ministry of Jesus. What meals can you think of, or things to do with meals, apart from the Last Supper, where we are this evening?
Martha and Mary.
Martha and Mary, where Jesus is eating in their house.
The first miracle, wedding at Cana.
The first miracle, wedding at Cana, and Jesus changing water into wine.
5,000.
The picnic on the beach after the resurrection, and the miraculous catch of fish, and discovering that Jesus has got there first, and has already cooked bread.
The loaves and fishes.
The loaves and fishes. The lovely picture in the Gospel of John of the boy who brings the little he has, and Philip recognizes it. Anything else?
Zacchaeus,
I'm coming to your house for tea.
Yes.
Yeah. Anything else?
Emmaus Road.
Pardon?
Emmaus Road.
The Emmaus Road, when they recognize Jesus in the breaking of the bread. Any more? This is good. There's the meal at the house of Simon the Pharisee, where the woman anoints Jesus, which in John's Gospel has a parallel story about Mary, the sister of Lazarus, anointing Jesus as he reclines at table. And then such a simple thing. But it then requires about 5 minutes patient kneeling. It's a simple thing. Pardon? Then you know it proves I'm overwarm. Actually, it'll be fine in here. So I won't have the smell of bread wafting through. That's where I'm at. But it will grow a little. And then there is the culmination of this story about meals, with this beautiful story told in all four Gospels of the time Jesus gathers for the Passover meal in the upper room. In John's Gospel, the story of the Last Supper, the final meal, actually takes up more than half the Gospel, well, almost half the Gospel. We start the story in chapter 13, and we finish the story in chapter 18, as the Passion story begins. So this meal is so important that John sets six chapters of his Gospel here. But curiously, doesn't have the institution of the Holy Communion as part of his story. Luke sets in his Gospel story the very important conversation about greatness in the kingdom of heaven, with Jesus saying, "It shall not be so among you. The greatest among you must be like one who serves." John has already has set at the beginning of his account of the Last Supper the act we will commemorate in 9 days' time, the foot washing. That too comes in the story of the Last Supper. And Matthew, Mark, and Luke all have the institution of the Eucharist, the Holy Communion. And they give most of their emphasis there. But actually, what I want to do with the passage this evening, I'm going to set this in here now and see how big it's become by the end of the evening. Oh, thank you very much. Okay. A round of applause for my assistant. What it would be really, the way I want to talk to you about the story. story this evening is this simple account of the Passover meal, the Last Supper. He's actually, for a Christian reading the account, a story not of one meal, but of three meals. And every time we come to the story in the biblical account, we come to the story, or we should, as a story of three occasions for meals together, and not simply one. The first account and the first meal is the Passover. This is the occasion on which the disciples gather. They're not gathering in the story, in the framework of the narrative, because this is the night before Jesus' death. The disciples don't yet understand that it is. They're not gathering because Jesus intends to draw them together and institute the Eucharist. They're gathering because it is the Feast of the Passover. And this is what the Jewish nation did and does on this night of the year. People come together and they eat a meal and they look back to the origins of the nation and to the story of the Exodus. You read the beginning of the passage. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. The Passover meal is a traditional meal of lamb and herbs, where every act of the meal has meaning, where there is dialogue in each moment of the meal as it unfolds. And it remembers the night at the beginning of the story of the nation, when Israel is held in captivity in Egypt. And Moses, in the early chapters of Exodus, is going to Pharaoh again and again, saying on God's behalf, "Let my people go." And each time that Moses goes, there is another plague visited on Pharaoh when he will not let God's people go. And the last and the greatest of the disasters that befall the Egyptians is the slaying of the firstborn, the final plague. And on the night before the slaying of the firstborn, God gives instructions to the Israelites through Moses that in order to escape this disaster which is coming on the Egyptians, they are to take a lamb, and they are to put the blood of the lamb on the doorposts and the lintel of their home, and they are to gather within that house, and they are to roast the lamb and eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs to remember their slavery in Egypt. And they are to eat it fully dressed and ready to go. In the Exodus story, the angel visits the Egyptians and the terrible calamity of the slaying of the firstborn happens, but not to the Israelites, who have set the blood of the lamb on the doorposts of their house. The angel passes over those homes. And they then are able to leave their slavery in Egypt and begin the long journey to freedom in the Promised Land. When we come to the Last Supper, and as we gather as Christians for the Eucharist, we have in our minds this moment of Passover. We have in mind our origin as the people of God, in God's call to Abraham and to Moses, and that we are grafted into, as Christian people, the long story of the people of God. And we have in our minds as well the particular interpretation of the person of Jesus Christ, first given by John the Baptist, and there in all the Gospels, the association of Jesus as the Lamb of God who is slain to bring freedom and release to those who are held captive. And he is God's firstborn, as it were, the only begotten Son of God. And he offers his life, and the blood is put on the wood of the cross, and so that God's people, through grace and faith, might be set free. So this meal that Jesus is sharing looks back with every other Passover that there has ever been to that founding act of the nation, but also looks forward to the next day, to the act of sacrifice that will be made, and to Jesus' death as the Lamb of God. When we sing in the Eucharist, Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, have mercy on us, we are drawing down into our worship the story of the Passover and our freedom from slavery and captivity and death to the freedom of the children of God. That is the first meal in the story. The second meal is, of course, the Eucharist. Jesus is forming a new people, a new Israel. And he gives to his new people a new meal, a solemn way of remembering him. While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." Jesus forms his community through the gift of his death on the cross. And he gives to the community a meal which will bind them together. There's always a binding together when we share food and drink together. It's always a great grace and joy. But this is at the Last Supper more than simply sharing food and drink together, because the different elements of the meal themselves are shared. Jesus does not give to each of the disciples a loaf and a cup. He gives to all of the disciples a loaf, and he breaks it and shares it with them. So they all share in one bread. He gives to all of the disciples a cup, and they all drink from the same cup. The symbolism is deeply important. They are joined together by sharing in this meal. Jesus takes for the meal he gives to his people very ordinary things and yet a very special thing. The ordinary things in bread, the special, not probably every day, certainly for those who are not well off, is the wine. The bread, the ordinary food and drink, the staple diet. And the wine, the symbol of joy and celebration, but also suffering. And the two woven and mingled together in one profound and deep mystery. And Jesus puts a particular interpretation here and in the other stories of the institution on the meaning of what he is giving to them. Mark's is the briefest account, but even here there is a meaning given to these things. Take. Well, there is this fourfold action in the meal. Jesus takes the bread, he gives thanks, that's why we call this meal the Eucharist. He breaks it, and he gives it. And he says as he gives it, take, this is my body. Not this represents my body, not this is a sign of my body. This is my body, my gift to you, my presence with you. Christians have debated fiercely down the years what that actually means, and still debated, actually, in the service I will be going to tomorrow, which commemorates the death of Archbishop Thomas Cranmer. His death and trial turned around the different understandings of what Jesus means here when he says, this is my body. Whether this is symbolic or representative or real or a substantive change. But the truth is here in what Jesus says. This is my body, his gift to us. And then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Jesus is instituting here a new covenant in the long series of covenants in Scripture, a covenant which is made with Abraham, the covenant which is made with Moses, the covenant which is made with David, the even older covenant which is made with Noah. A solemn, binding commitment and contract between God and people, which confers grace and gifts and benefits. And this is the covenant of freedom and forgiveness and love, which is poured out for many. A looking forward to Jesus' death on the next day. A clear communication that Jesus' death is not something which is taken from him, but which he gives willingly. Something which is given in love for the world. And the narrative, which is older in the Bible, in 1 Corinthians 12, more explicit on this meaning. Sorry, 1 Corinthians 11. Paul writes this, "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The explicit command to the disciples, which Paul applies to the church, that when we are to meet together, we are to do this in remembrance of Jesus. In the same way, he took a cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The Lord gives to the church, through the disciples, this most wonderful gift, which binds us together, one loaf, one cup. The Lord gives this most wonderful gift, which is our remembrance of him, our making present his sacrifice and his story, and enacting it in the midst of the community week by week. The Lord gives us this profound and deep sign and assurance that we are forgiven, that he has poured out his life for us, and that we are made new. And the Lord gives us this profound spiritual food by which we are nurtured week by week. Much earlier in the Gospel of Mark, when Jesus calls the first disciples, there is a wonderful description of why he calls them and us. At the beginning of Mark 3, Jesus goes up the mountain to pray. And having spent the night in prayer, he calls the 12 to him. And the text in Mark says this: to be with him and to be sent out. To be with him and to be sent out. Mark is making a statement there, not simply about what happened to the group around Jesus, but a statement about the life of the church. But Jesus calls 12 disciples, the equivalent of the 12 tribes of Israel. This is the new community which is being formed. And our purpose is stated in this beautiful rhythm of coming together to be with Jesus and being sent out in mission and service in the world. We come together to be with Christ, and we are sent out in mission and service in the world. We are called to be people who live in that rhythm, coming together to be fed and nurtured and being sent out. Later in the Gospel, Jesus will be asked, "Which is the greatest commandment?" And Jesus will reply at subverting the question, not giving one answer, but two. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The same rhythm, coming together to be with Jesus, loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and being sent out to love our neighbour as ourselves. And in the Eucharist, and in the commandment, "Do this in remembrance of me," Jesus sets that same rhythm right at the heart of the life of the new community. For we are to come together to be with the risen Christ together, around his body and his blood given for us, and his word which nurtures us. And that meal feeds us and builds us up and sustains us, so that we are then sent out to live in God's service in the whole of our lives. John Wesley describes the Eucharist as a converting ordinance. It draws us in to the love of God and shows God's love to us in a practical, tangible way as we become part of Christ again in his body, and Christ becomes part of us. So sometimes we will come to the Eucharist with joy, full of the good things, and are caught up in the thanksgiving. And sometimes we will come to the Eucharist tired and worn down, and perhaps not able to think or to pray or to do anything, simply then be there. I think it's in those moments that our experience of the Eucharist is the deepest. For all we need to do is to remember our spiritual poverty and come to God with empty hands. And God, as it were, nurtures us with his very life, as Elijah was fed by ravens in the desert. So in the Eucharist, God reaches out to us and nurtures us in those ways. And it's in the Eucharist that we gain week by week and month by month and over the whole rhythm of our lives that deeper appreciation of the width and breadth and length and height of the love of God. And so we are drawn in by that deeper appreciation to a deeper offering of our lives back to God. Wesley's words mean a great deal to me because, insofar as I can understand the story of my journey into Christ and the story of my discipleship, the particular moment when God's grace was deepest for me was in a service of Holy Communion when I was a young teenager away on a weekend. And I understood, and how I'm still not sure, many years later, both the deep extent of God's love for me and also the call to offer my life back to God in that beautiful prayer by David Frost that we say at the end of most of our communion services, based on Romans 12. We offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. We're drawn into God again in the rhythm of the Eucharist, and we offer our lives to God again in our discipleship week by week. Discovered a new image for that in the studies that we've been developing on the story of the raising of Lazarus, and I hadn't realized before, looking at the Lazarus story closely over the last year, that the Lazarus story continues into the story of Mary anointing Jesus for his passion at the beginning of John 12, which has become a very profound and precious picture of laying everything at the feet of Christ in response to God's grace and love. So as we journey to the upper room, there is that profound sense of Passover, the first meal. There is the beautiful encounter with the very beginning of the tradition of the Eucharist, but the beginning in which everything is present. But there is also a third meal in this encounter. As the feast in heaven. There are lots of, when you Google heavenly banquet, I discovered this morning, there are lots of truly appalling pictures that come up on your screen of angels in heaven and clouds and all kinds of unhelpful pictures. So I thought a picture of food from above was actually a much better one. Curiously, most of them were empty tables and chairs, so there was no food in sight. But back to the passage. It's just a very nice verse. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." This meal, which is a Passover looking back and a Eucharist looking forward to the life of the church, looks forward even further to Jesus drinking the wine new in the kingdom of God. And the same is there in the 1 Corinthians passage. We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. As we gather, whether we're gathering a few people in a home communion or a service in a parish church or in a cathedral or in a fresh expression of church in a new estate, we are gathering and joining our worship to the worship of heaven. And we are gathering in anticipation of the great feast, and of the moment when Christ will be present to us as Lord and King, and the kingdom of God will come in all its fullness. And we meet in that hope and expectation that the fellowship we enjoy here is fellowship with the saints in heaven, with God's church down the ages, and it is fellowship which will continue and endure beyond death, when God's kingdom of justice and peace will have come in all its fullness. We look forward together. And that is so important in living out our Christian lives, that we are nurtured in the hope of our calling. Not simply our own individual calling, that we will one day be with Christ, but our hope for the setting right of the earth and the fulfilling of God's promises. The third meal is the meal for which all creation longs and groans and wants to see when the world is set right by the grace of God. Three meals in the eating and drinking. The Passover. The Lamb looking back to the formation of the nation and the journey from slavery to freedom. The Eucharist looking forward to the gathering of the church in this rhythm of coming together to be with the risen Christ and sent out, of being reminded of the grace and love of God in this memorial of his passion, and offering our lives again in service, of coming with empty hands, of being fed and nurtured and filled, and looking forward to the feast in heaven. I thought I'd finish connections, if I may, between this meal and these three meals in one, and the prayer that Jesus gives us, which we pray in our Anglican liturgy just as we come to communion. At the end of the great Eucharistic prayer, which is prayed by the priest in the liturgy, which echoes all of the themes that we've been talking about. We kneel together as the family of God, and we say these words: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We remember who we are, and that we are loved by God, and the holiness of the God who calls us. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. We remind one another that the world is not yet as God intends it to be, and that we are hoping together for God's kingdom to be realized, for the feast, the wedding feast of the Lamb. Give us this day our daily bread. We need to be sustained in body, mind, and spirit. And we need to be sustained daily as we come to God and in the rhythm of our life. You can't have enough spiritual food, if you go back to the story of the manna in the wilderness, to stock you up for a month or 2 months. We need to keep coming back to God. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. We are a community of imperfect people. And we continually need to seek the forgiveness of Christ, who gives us the prayer, who is himself the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And we continually need to be reconciled with one another and to let go of the things that we hold against each other as we come together in the name of Christ and our one body and exchange the peace and drink from the common cup. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Reminds us that in our Christian lives and journey, there will be times of testing and difficulty and suffering. And the Christ who gives his life for us on the cross also says, "Take up your cross and follow me." And the Christ who gives us the cup of wine does so in the knowledge that there will be suffering as well as joy in our experience of human life. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. The doxology at the end of the prayer added by the church that looks forward again from where we are now to the glory that will be revealed in us. The Lord, in his prayer, gives us this powerful daily reminder of who we are, of daily bread, of what we are called to. So as you eat and drink, the bread, I guess, has risen a little.
It's a miracle. It started off as 11
and it's just the same as it was at least. But by the time I get home, it'll be ready for me. I'll send a picture for you. In this one beautiful meal, we look back, we look around, we look out, and we look forward in hope as a community together. Thank you for listening.
comments, you know the form, just raise your hand and the microphone will be placed in your hands.
You can nearly say it was food for thought.
Well, either very good or very bad. Well, everyone,
I'll taste the bread.
Well, while other people are thinking, could I ask you one question? Mm. You talked a bit about John's Gospel. And it's always that struck me that John's account of this meal doesn't speak about the meal itself. Yeah. And I wonder whether you had a view on why that was. I mean, there are lots of other absences in John's Gospel as well. Baptism, for example, only alluded to. But this always seems rather strange.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, John's Gospel is full of mystery. And I kind of think that's the point. I certainly believe John is writing for communities which have Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and therefore is looking to say and do things which helps those communities look deeper at the same story. And what I'm finding in John, really interestingly, is that some of the episodes which are there in the other three Gospels are just put in a different place in the narrative in John. That's certainly true of the Lazarus story, where another thing I noticed in Lazarus was that the agony in the garden isn't there in John's Gospel. But actually, I think in the Lazarus story, the moment of agony is Jesus weeping before the tomb of Lazarus, before he calls him out, which is the moment that Jesus is then committed to his own death. And I think the breaking of bread is found in John, in the miracle in John 6, and the same words are used there. So, and the wine, of course, in Cana, and then in the discourse on the vine. So I think we just look in different places, and that takes us deeper in our understanding, in a curious kind of way.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop. Could you say something about the role of Judas within the meal? Because that's the sort of the bit that you haven't talked about, and it's the role of the traitor in the midst, who's still nonetheless eating with the master.
Yeah.
But in particular, it would have been better for that one not to have been born.
Mm. Thank you. I think the role of Judas within the meal is severalfold. Really, obviously, there are layers of meaning to the Judas story. One of them is that Judas is a sign. Well, he's a dramatic person in the narrative, and he has a part to play in the story of the Passion and Resurrection. He is a reminder of the imperfection of the Christian community and of the group of the disciples. And is a reminder to us all of human fallibility and the fallibility of the church, which I think is there. He is a reminder, I think, of the compassion of Christ for him, because Jesus doesn't throw him out, as it were, he includes him in it. And the challenge to go on loving. But you're right to say, I think, that Jesus is one of the characters in this, Judas is one of the characters in the story, mm-hmm. that we stumble over and need to think about deeply. Thank you.
Thank you for a very enjoyable evening. I'm looking on there and I'm hoping that I'm going to get a courage or a evening. One of my favourite passages in the Gospel is the story of the road to Emmaus. Mm. And I find it fascinating that those two disciples, I think we assume they were disciples as opposed to apostles, that they recognised him in one thing, and that was the breaking of bread. So I'm wondering whether the so-called Last Supper was the first time that he'd done that, or whether there were previous occasions where perhaps he had made this part of the Christian faith earlier on.
Thank you. I think that the pattern of taking, giving thanks, breaking and giving, there is evidence for that in other places in the Gospels, particularly in the miracles of the feeding of the 5,000 in the words that are used. It's hard to be exactly sure whether that is the Gospel writers using particular terms for the earlier miracle, or whether that's part of the pattern of Jesus. But I agree with you, and I think it's likely that this was not the first time he'd taken bread in that way, though the interpretation is very powerful because of the night before the crucifixion. I think also in the Emmaus Road story, the recognition of the risen Christ is cumulative, in because they also say later, were not our hearts burning within us as we walked on the road? And actually, it's a number of things coming together to set their hearts on fire, of which the culmination is that moment when Jesus breaks the bread.
Thank you.
Sitting around the table and sharing them together, how sad it is really that that happens so little these days.
Yeah.
And people sitting on the couch with it on their lap and they never enjoy that moment of togetherness. And I think too, I mean, you must, I'm thinking now of the school settings when children eat and have a meal at lunchtime in school, and you've probably been in schools where they're doing this. Even there, I think, even is enough emphasis and encouragement made to sort of make that a moment of joining together. I recall years ago a priest and his family, they had a very simple grace, actually. It was just holding hands together around the table and just saying, each time we eat, may we remember God's love. It's very fitting, I think.
It is.
It's very
helpful.
Very simple.
Yeah.
You know, not for what we are about receiving. It was much more meaningful, I believe.
Yeah.
And I wish we could encourage more people to do that as they join together and eat.
No, I'm sure you're right. Thank you. And I think the saying of grace in the hope is what actually research has shown. That it's one of the most effective things parents can do to pass on faith to their children. And also, looking around the room, grandparents. it's the taking of prayer out of the public space into the domestic space, which all kinds of good things can flow from that. And it's so worth the time it takes. It doesn't take more than 30 seconds before the meal, just to have a moment of reflection and pray.
Food's been on the screen too long.
Well, Bishop Stephen, thank you very much for this evening. When I thought of the idea for this series of lectures, I think I hoped from each lecture for three things. One was a quite a detailed exposition of the Bible passage in a way that is not possible, particularly in the busy week that Holy Week is, but it's not possible in the length of a normal sermon. Secondly, that growing out of that, there would be some nourishment for our own faith and understanding, and that we would go out knowing more and sensing more than we did when we came in. And also, I hope that we would discover something about the people who were lecturing to us. And I think if that was the aim, you fulfilled it absolutely. You would have added actual nourishment rather than just pictures. And it's a crying shame that we don't have an oven that works. And I say this on behalf of all those who are working towards getting us a new kitchen. But for all of that, especially for the apparently simple and gentle way in which you presented this mysterious and deeply moving event, I'd like to thank you, and I'd like to thank you on behalf of all of us, because it's been just what I might have hoped for.
Thank you.
So if I could just make a couple of announcements. This is not the last one. There is one more on the agony in the garden, or as it's been set out in the series about praying. And we'll see where that goes. And if you'd like to come along, you'd be very welcome. Also, as you go out, would you please take a yellow flyer, which sets out the services and special events that will be taking place in the parish during Holy Week, and particularly look for those places where we've tried to build on this lecture series and kind of carry it through into our meditations and indeed into our services throughout Holy Week and up as far as Good Friday. And at least one of the family services will be looking in different ways at some of the events that we have described to us. So please take that and have a look at it now, so that you'll be able to plan ahead, see those things that you would like to do during that very special week of the year. Finally, there will be a basket outside, but I wanted to say that people have been so generous in previous weeks that I think probably already we'll have covered most, if not all, of the extra costs. But if you would like to continue to contribute anything above those costs, we would like to give to an urgent appeal that has just come from Jack just around the corner, about which you'll be hearing more if you're members of this parish later on. So I leave it up to you, and there's no obligation, obviously, in any way at all. Would you mind sending us out with a prayer or a blessing, whatever you think is appropriate?
Yes, we keep a moment of stillness and quietness, and I will lead us in the Lord's Prayer and the prayer vessel. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
peace of God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you, now and always.
Amen.